better than I usually do it. So how many waves is this? And the wavelength's not going to change. That thing's vibrating back and forth 512 times a second. In that duration, sound's only going to travel. It will travel the same distance. It's a question of how big the air column needs to be. And so L is going to be 3/4 of that, which is 0.468.
Are all of these considered first harmonics, or are these called fraction harmonics of some kind?
The first harmonic is the simplest.
So is that a first harmonic or a 1/4 harmonic?
That's a first harmonic. That. It's only in the video. I mentioned it.
I believe that's just a
What'd
first
you say?
Harmonic.
I didn't say anything.
Oh.
First harmonic again?
No.
No, it's like third harmonic.
Yeah, it's the third harmonic.
Oh, does it depend on the numerator?
Actually, yeah. Second harmonic, I'm really not sure if it has any meaning at all. It's not something that we can actually produce. So it does sort of first. The second one we can produce is the third harmonic, because, sure, why not? Well, basically, because of that. So the third harmonic should happen down here somewhere. And I am going to use the trash can. Sorry about the metal on metal. All right, it was 46.8 on here plus the 2. I'm gonna be off by 2 centimeters. Did I see that right? Because usually we're closer than that. So we had 46.8 plus the 2, 48.8, and we had a prediction of 46.8 centimeters, and so we're off by about 5%.
I think it's 0.498.
498, ah.
Yes.
And we had 0.488.
Yes.
Okay, that's any better. Now we're off by 1 centimeter out of that, so that's about 2% off. I'll say doing this lab, you will not do this lab, I'm not going to schedule it. Doing this lab is sort of difficult because if you have more than one person doing this in the room, hearing the harmonic is not necessarily, at least for me, it's not particularly easy because I hear a harmonic and I'm thinking it's the one I'm next to, but it's the one across the room. But fortunately, we do labs when we have a lot of open room, so we can spread out if we did it. Questions to hear? All right, the derivation of the Doppler effect is in one of the videos, so I'm not going to reproduce that one. Let's just actually just use it.
Is that an O or a U?
That's an O. Or a zero, whichever way you want. All right, so I have a car coming at me. And I'm standing here in the middle of the road. He honks his horn because I'm in the middle of the road. This is going to be speed of the observer, the speed of the source. These are the speed of sound. It's a question of where do I put a plus or a minus?
Do we have to make a coordinate axis for this?
No. The frequency that we would hear as the car comes towards us is going to be higher, and I'm sure all of you have experienced this. If you've been beside, walking on the side of the road when a car goes by, you hear that as the frequency is higher and then lower. So if the car is coming towards me, am I going to hear a higher frequency than the driver hears, or a lower frequency? So in terms of pluses and minuses, since the source is moving, I need to set up this fraction so that this is higher than that is. So would that make this a plus or a minus?
Maybe minus?
Is it maybe minus?
Yeah.
Well, given a choice of a plus or minus, it may be a minus. You want to be
I'm
going to
go with minus for now.
You're going with minus for now? So you're saying that if I make the denominator smaller, I'm going to get a fraction bigger than one? That was badly worded.
Yeah.
Try that one again. Speed of sound is the speed of sound. It's going to change upon the temperature, but we'll assume that it's relatively constant in this problem. So about 340. So if the observer and the car are both not moving relative to each other, so you're out in the front lawn, or in front of the apartment building, or wherever, you're out front, and somebody's car horn is stuck, you're gonna hear the same frequency whether you're standing there or whether you're in that car. If it's coming towards, the source is moving. So if I subtract, back it up for a second, so if they're at rest relative to each other, then the frequency heard is the frequency of the source, or the sort of the original. So this fraction is one. If it's coming towards you, I want this fraction to be greater than one, because I'm going to multiply times this to get a higher number. And what Robin was claiming is that if I make the denominator smaller.
Wait, wasn't the right side of the equation supposed to be smaller?
The right side. This is supposed to be smaller than that.
Oh, it's 340 over 340 on the left side?
No, that's... If they're at rest relative to each other, this equation would become the frequency is equal to whatever sound frequency is. 340 minus, plus or minus zero. Minus or plus zero. Which is just, so the frequency that is heard is the same as the frequency of the source.
Yep. makes sense to me, at least, I might be wrong, that if you are subtracting something from the denominator, then the whole side is going to be smaller than the left side.
So if I subtracted from, so if I had 340 over 300, so I subtracted, I'm going to get something smaller. Let's use some real numbers here. Suppose that the initial frequency is 400 hertz.
That's pretty loud.
You're saying that this is less than 400?
No, I'm wrong then.
All right, so if we make the denominator smaller here, we're going to get a higher number than this. I know it's awkwardly worded questions, but I'm hoping that it'll get at least some acknowledgement that if this denominator becomes smaller than the numerator, that this whole thing will become something bigger than this is.
Yes.
So if the car is coming towards you, you'll be subtracting on the bottom because we need a higher frequency. If it's subtracting on the bottom, it's plus on top. So this is coming towards you. If the source is going away, I would hear a lower frequency. So I would add on the bottom and subtract on top. In essence, it's a matter of, I've seen tables in books where they talk about directions of the source, directions of the observer, et cetera, et cetera. And what I'm saying is think through it to determine where the plus and minuses go. So if the source is approaching the observer, it's a negative there. If the observer is heading towards the source, it's a plus there. So the source toward observer toward source. If they are chasing each other, so the observer is going, say, 20 meters per second that way, the car is moving 20 meters per second that way, they are at rest relative to each other, so however I do this, I need to make sure that this ends up being the same as that.
So as soon as, say, the car passes the person, it would flip?
Yes.
There's no situation where you have both positive and both negative?
There actually is. I got overzealous.
Is that like what you're talking about with the chasing?
Yeah. Sorry. I tweaked my back the other day by having the audacity to lean over.
That wasn't smart.
No. I need to make everything in the house raised up so I don't have to lean over.
How tall are you again?
6'4".
Damn.
All right, so car going at 20 meters per second. Observer, we'll just start out at rest. So the frequency the observer will hear, but OB for the observer is going to be the frequency of this. We'll say that this is 400 hertz, is the frequency that driver is hearing is 400 hertz. Times some fraction, I know it's going to be a higher frequency because it is approaching. It's going to be 340, the observer's not moving, plus or minus zero, whichever your mood is. And then on the bottom, I know that the frequency is going to be higher, so I need to make the denominator smaller since my numerator is not the same, it's not changing. So 340 minus 20. If we crank through the math, is that the one I just did over there? No, it's not the one I did over there. So we get 340 over 320. And we get something.
Say
it again?
425.
425. if we now have the car staying still, still 400 hertz. And this time the observer is going away at 20 meters per second. Well, if the observer is going away at 20 meters per second, higher frequency or lower frequency? And so the frequency observed is going to be 400 times, well, the source isn't moving, so that's 340 plus or minus zero. And on top, 340, I want this to be a smaller number, so minus 20. So we end up with 400 times 320 over 340, which gives us something magical.
Hertz.
In which case would the would F equal F zero?
If they were at rest relative to each other. So if my car is now traveling at 20 meters per second to the right, and the observer is moving at 20 meters per second to the right.
Okay, thank you.
However we manipulate this, they are at rest relative to each other. So this would be a case where, well, the car is coming towards the observer, so I'm going to subtract 20 from the bottom. The observer is moving away from the source, so I'm going to subtract 20 from the top. And so I'd end up with 400 times 340 minus 20 on top, and 340 minus 20 on the bottom. Thank you.
Hurts.
Thank you. That's about fake points off.
Would you take points off if we just go 1 of 9 seconds or seconds and 30?
That's fine. I'm good with that. And if the person is traveling at the speed of sound, the observer. Now let's keep the, it's like the observer still, but this time the car is traveling at 340 meters per second. What happens to the math?
It just doubles the hertz, right?
Is that what the math says?
I'm not sure.
The bottom denominator is now zero. So, and the bottom.
So, based upon our Doppler shift, we'd end up with the frequency that's being heard is that 400 times 340 plus or minus zero, and then 340 minus 340. So obviously this formula breaks down at this point, because you're not necessarily going to hear an infinite, well, you would not hear an infinitely high frequency.
Well, is the car going to hit you about the same time the sound does?
Yeah, that's true. So therefore you would not hear it. Remember, what's actually hitting your eardrum is compression and rarefaction. Compression hits your eardrum, it pushes your eardrum in. Rarefaction hits your eardrum, it pulls your eardrum out. Your eardrum's gonna pop back and forth. Signals get transmitted to your brain, you hear sound, in theory. Or if you have damage, sometimes you just hear that sound constantly.
Oh, that we would call that tinnitus.
Yes. So, if we think about this in terms of pressure waves hitting us, what happens in terms of the pressure waves if the car is traveling at the speed of sound?
They're effectively building up on top of each other.
Yep.
Do they neutralize if the rarefaction and the compression aren't the same?
If you have compression and rarefaction, sort of peak compression, peak rarefaction on top of each other, in theory, it cancel out.
Okay. Does it?
Yeah.
Okay.
However, it's generally not noticed because you get hit by that huge compression wave to start with, and it just sounds like a loud boom.
And when, which, so when your ears pop, is it compression or rarefaction?
That's just a difference in pressure. The pressure inside your head is higher than the pressure, let's see, ears pop going up and coming down. So in one case, it pops because the pressure is higher in your head. In another case, it pops when the pressure in your head is lower.
Okay, thank you.
My recollection, I haven't been on a plane in 10 years. And I'll never be on a plane again. But anyway, it's more of an issue when you're coming down off.
What happens when the person in the car doing this? I mean, why would they, but if they were?
Sorry, say that again?
So if the person is going towards the car and the car is going towards the person at the same time?
Then you're going to hit those peaks even faster.
Okay.
And so you would, that's the situation where you would add on top and subtract on the bottom. Making that fraction larger will give you a higher frequency, and I can make the fraction higher two different ways. I can make the denominator smaller or the numerator bigger. My belief is, if you just think about it just for a little bit, it'll make sense whether you add or subtract. I've had too many students in the past try to memorize and